Filters are about to change in Photoshop. Check out these new parametric filters, which are in the Photoshop beta. If you want early access, go up to the Creative Cloud, go down to Beta Apps, and then download the Photoshop beta. So to find it, we choose Filter, Parametric Filters. And you'll see this box appear. At the end, I'm going to give a quick rundown of each filter and whether it's useful or not. But right now, we're going to look at how to use them. What we need to do is just go down and then click on the filter. Properties panel will appear. The best way to use it is with both panels side by side. If you don't see the filter panel, just go into your toolbar there and make sure we've got it and tear it off so we can see them side by side. When you apply the filter, it duplicates the layer and creates a smart object. When the properties open up, we have the ability to choose the resolution. I recommend starting on a lower resolution and then go to ultra when you're done to get a better result. But for speed, let's not do that until we're happy with the result. One of the areas you're going to work in the most is going to be under the presets. So if we look in the presets here, we can see for this particular filter, this is a vintage photo. We can see a low contrast, high contrast, and a mid contrast. At any of these properties can be adjusted just by adjusting the sliders. So we can reduce the grain intensity if we want. I'm just going to dock this with the parametric filter right now, just for the sake of space, because I'm working in a lower resolution. And then we can do things like we can change the vignette color. If we wanted something a little bit more of a brownish, less black, we could do that. And then we've got a lot of control over this, like you wouldn't have in any other way. And if we want, we could save that as another preset. And that will be added to our presets. So generally speaking, once we've got those adjustments, then we would go in and then we would just hit Ultra and it will re-render much smoother. Now there's a lot more I want to show you. And if you're getting any value out of this video, hit that subscribe button, turn on notifications, you won't miss any of my videos. But first of all, where do these come from? What makes these filters so powerful is that they can be created inside of Substance 3D Designer. We're not going to do this today. Maybe in the future I'll do a tutorial on it. But we can basically build our own filters and export them out. And then once you've done that, you can go under My Filters, hit the plus, and you could import them. But you can also import filters which are going to be created by other people, which means we're just going to have access to so many filters so quickly like never before. All right, let's get into some of the juicy features in here. So right now we've got this kind of vintage filter. If we wanted to change it to something else, such as a color, we just simply click on it and notice it will change it out to the other filter. So we could literally just click through here, choosing different filters by simply clicking on them. Now, if we want to stack filters on top of each other, we can. If we hold down the Alt or the Option key, we can click and this will add additional filters on top. So as you can see here, now we've got two filters on top of each other. Okay, let's go a little deeper. So if we want to apply it maybe just to the background, we can grab one of our selection tools and we'll just choose select subject. And this will select our model. Command Shift I will inverse the selection. So now we've got everything selected except for our model. So let's choose filter and we're going to grab the parametric filters. So say we wanted to apply the distortion filter. We would just click on that filter. Now it's applied just to the background and you can see a mask is created with the smart object. We can hit randomize. And each time we hit randomize, it'll create a new random seed, which will just kind of change how it looks for things like noise and turbulence. A random seed is just a random starting number that it uses before it applies all the calculations. If we want to add a second filter, hold down the Alt or the Option key and click on the filter you want to add. Notice a second filter is now added. You can see it there. Let's change a preset. So we're going for some kind of a glitch TV screen effect. And then if we want, we could even stack an additional one. So hold down the Alt or the Option key and let's hit a color. Notice it adds a third filter. And why don't we go for a gradient? Except the color I want to sample from here. So let's grab the color picker, roll over the image, and let's go for that pinkish tone. click OK. Now it's going from top to bottom. We want to change the rotation. Notice all these parameters can be changed. Now it's happening from the left, so the colors are kind of matching a little bit more. Now, if you wanted to change the parameters in just one of these filters, now that we've got them stacked, click at the top and you'll notice there they are. So there's our distortion filter here. If we wanted to change to a different preset, like maybe warping or something, we could grab it there. And notice how that filter blends with the other ones to create a brand new result. And right now, let's do a quick rundown of the filters. So the first one is black and white vintage. And then we start to mix with some blending modes and opacity, it becomes a little bit more useful. This is not my favorite of the filters. Chromatic aberration. So this could be quite useful for creating glitch effects if we combine it with other ones, such as the hologram. We can start to get an old kind of a TV, glitchy TV kind of an effect. The color one's interesting. This one enables us to, you know, overlay different colors, to blend them together. We can get some interesting color grading effects, and also we can use this for a gradient overlay if we want to just apply the gradient to part of the image. And a distortion here is another one, and this can be used to create, you know, different types of glitch effects. Maybe be combined with different filters and adjusted, you know, to not make them quite so glitchy. We have Duotone, which is a quick way to apply two different colors to the shadows and highlights. Some of the presets have some interesting colors here that might be reminiscent of different types of film stock. And if you adjust the opacity with the original image, you can start to build some pretty realistic vintage filmic effects this way. So that's a useful filter. So Emboss, I'm sure it has its uses, but doesn't do very much for me. Glass filter, if you want to create a glass effect on top. And this could actually work quite nicely, because we've got this fire happening at one of the hangars in Tustin here, unfortunately. I can create a mask, I can grab a brush, paint it away from the other areas, and now we can create some kind of a heat effect. Also similar to what you would see, you know, off the engines of a jet or something like that. So yes, that one definitely has some uses. Then we've got another glitch one. You could use that in combination with some of the other ones to build that glitch effect that I talked about, if that's what you're looking for. It's not something you're going to use every day, but if you need that effect, it's there. Halftone. This is kind of interesting. This is, we've been trying to create the halftone dots. And we can do stripes if we want. We can also choose colors. You can see some of that's already built into the presets. The hologram that we looked at, this is kind of cool. I like this one. This gives us the ability to kind of create these TV or projector kind of looks. That's one I'll definitely be using. There's a second holographic filter, which personally, I don't like this one as much as the other one. It just looks, I don't know. I feel like the first one looks better. Oil painting. You can start to mess around with, you know, changing the amount of details. And you could definitely have fun with this. I know people can never get enough of these type of oil paint filters, so just experiment with that. I'll show you the different presets. There's the sketch, directional painting. Of course, all these parameters can be adjusted. Soften. Or default. I know a lot of people will have fun with that one. Pattern. This one's kind of interesting. So this creates a repeating pattern, like a video wall, but it also has some other interesting things we can do here. Create some kind of a sound wave. Random, just kind of stacks them together. And of course, we can change the amount and the size, all that different stuff. Offset. Kind of like the TV wall, but you have a gap in between. And missing tile is interesting. It's a little bit more random looking. I could see this one having some uses from time to time. Pixelate. The old pixelization. I don't need to explain that. Rain filter. And this one will create the illusion of rain. And this is quite interesting. I kind of like this because we have the ability to adjust the darkness. It's we can go from original colors to very kind of gloomy. And of course we can change the density of the rain or the strength. Scratch one. This is one I think some people will find useful for textures. Now I could almost use this as a texture and just create a separate texture overlay and then maybe put this into overlay mode. And then start to use it with the original layer. And then just kind of bring it in a little bit, see how it could be kind of interesting like that. That's probably how I would use it. But we've got soft damages, high damages. And what I find interesting is burnt. And those are the properties we can adjust. We can adjust how burnt it is. So scratch photo, yep, that one's a winner. All right, so we have our snow filters here. Now, I'm sure it has its uses. To me, it doesn't really look like snow at all, but maybe you can use it for other things. I think the rain might be better for a snow one. Then there's Spherify, or how were we supposed to say that? Spherify, so it basically puts it in a sphere. So we can take it down, we can adjust it. We can adjust the size of the image within there. You get the general idea. Yeah, this could have its places. And one of them that's interesting is we have the tile 2. We'll create the sphere on top of the background. But here's the fun thing, it can actually be moved. So maybe you could use this for creating some kind of a raindrop effect. Okay, this sticker one's kind of interesting. Some people are like this and some people will probably hate it, but we can get the sticker effect. Symmetry is kind of interesting. So we have different ways of working with this. We can do blended or cutted. Cutted will just kind of create a kaleidoscope effect. And blended will create a more interesting kind of a thing. And we can go and look at all the different presets in here. There's tons and tons of presets in this one. But where I find this interesting is things like mirror X, mirror Y. And we can start to create some really interesting effects with that. And of course, we've already looked at vintage. So here's the parametric filters. I know some of these are useful and some of them aren't. Let me know your comments underneath and let me know what you think about it. If you want to see more of the new features in Photoshop, check out my video here. If you're new to the cafe, hit the subscribe button, turn on notifications, and you won't miss any of my tutorials. Until next time, I'll see you at the cafe.